We have at least most of the participants during this webinar. And I think I'll just start introducing myself and get this thing going. So my name is Cătălin Șindelaru. I work as a flight data specialist for L3Harris. And one of the tasks that I used to, and I still have, is to support these visualizations inquiries. So we do offer various solutions for visualizing a flight depending on the situation. So there are three of them in total. So we offer a in-browser visualization, a Google Earth module, and X-Plane. So what will happen now, I'll go through the advantages of each of those packages. And then at some point I'll stop and I'll ask you two questions and I'll do a short demonstration of a map overlay. So the first thing is...
Cătălin?
Yeah?
Can I just interrupt you before you start there? Good morning, everybody. This is Rob Holliday. During the webinar, if you'd like to ask questions, use the Q&A function, the text function, for any comments or any questions. And when we get to the end of the presentation, we will run through all of your questions and answer them for you. Back over to you, Cătălin.
Thank you very much, Rob. So I was saying that we have multiple types of products, one of them being this in-browser visualization. It is basically a module that starts as a window in any browser and you can visualize your flight. I'm sure the persons that have used Polaris by now are familiar with it. So on our platform, which is called Polaris, we just go into that flight. And if you click view graph, then you'll have a visualization ribbon and with an enable button. That's straightforward. I'll make some pauses every now and then because my presentation has a lot of video content. I just want to let the video to catch up with my voice so I don't go out of sync. Now, in this in-browser visualization, we can enable to see the events, the key time instances, and key point values. So this is being made by pressing the three buttons in the top corner. Let me see if I can hide this from here. Yeah. So normally I'd keep only the events in view because otherwise the trajectory of the aircraft gets cluttered with a lot of information unless you are hunting for a specific time of the flight. Now we can zoom and pan like in any other 3D software. You can change the angle of the camera. It's just like you'd normally do in any software. You just right click, hold the right click and move the mouse and then you'll move around the aircraft and use your scroll wheel to zoom in and zoom out. So that's fairly basic. There are some simple controls of the camera. It's like only the basics in which you can attach or detach a camera to the aircraft. So I think that would be useful in the situations in which, you know, let's say you want to see the touchdown point of a landing. So what I would do, I would scroll, I'll fast forward to the point of touchdown. I'll stop the video in there. I'll detach the camera, rewind back and play the movie again to see how the evolution of the aircraft was for that section of the flight. Also in the same window, by clicking any of the pinpoints along the trajectory, it will display the name of the key point value, key time instance, and it will show you the values that have been recorded. You can fast forward or rewind, as I just mentioned. The trick in here is to, if you're replaying a flight and you want to fast forward, you'll have first to pause the simulation and drag your slider to the position you want to fast forward the flight, and then click play again, as I just did in this presentation. And the thing that I like the most about the in-browser visualization is the fact that all the information you see in here, except the tabular data, is being synchronized in time. As in the position of the aircraft with the vertical slider that you can see on the charts, on the graphs, they're all playing in a synchronized manner. And also the ILS cone, the 2D map, all the labels that you see, they change and they update in accordance with the portion of the flight that you are replaying. Now, the next slide, it's about the 2D map. It's just a simple map, a top view that can be useful sometimes if you don't want to enable the entire 3D module and then try to align the camera with the top of the aircraft. You can use this one instead. It's very simple and straightforward. And one of the additions that we made to the in-browser, well, to the instrument panel, is the fact that for Boeing and Airbus, we started customizing the appearance of them and adding the FMA, the flight mode annunciators. So you can see in the top section, we see a speed, a lock, and a glide slope flag. So yeah, various other information in there. The same goes for Airbus. So we're trying to stick to the color scheme and the information in there. And we have two questions. I'll start with the first one. I'll read it out loud so everyone knows it. Is it possible to see the landing gear extension and retraction in the visualization? Yes, it is. I imagine Mohammed is speaking about extending the gear and retracting the gear in the in-browser visualization. So if you click play in any flight, after liftoff, you'll see the gear retracting and also at the landing extending. I hope I answered this question. We have two other questions. Can we display multiple aircraft data at the same time? So I'll read the question again from Vinod. Oh, that's a difficult surname. Gopalakrishnan, I hope I got it right. Yes, we can display multiple data at the same time. I imagine you're speaking about having like multiple charts, multiple graphs, multiple parameters displayed. So yeah, we can do that. Tobias is asking, how precise is the in-browser map position of the touchdown point? Well, that's a very simple question that we'll have to have quite a long answer, but I'll keep it short and I can come back to it later on. So there is a lot of smoothing, cleansing, and computation going behind the scenes. So I think the accuracy is as good as you'll ever get in this situation. Of course, it depends a lot on how accurate the lat and long parameters of the aircraft that we're speaking about is. But of course, I'll show you later in this presentation a simulation for a landing in which the aircraft didn't record any of the latitude or longitude. For those cases, we just extrapolate. We use the heading and ground speed to work out the track of the aircraft. I'll move on to the next questions. Stefan, are you expecting Geely EX and Falcon FMAs? No, it's not on our roadmap at the moment. This can change, but no, I'm not aware of any plans of implementing the FMA in Falcons. DME would, another question from Declan. DME would be very useful on the PFD. Well, I think it is. Oh, the DME distance, you mean. Right, yeah, noted. Let me see, perhaps on the general slide. I thought it is in here. Let me just double check. No, it's not. Yeah, good one. Yeah, we'll consider adding it. Just to clarify, can I display multiple flights at the same time? Not in the in-browser viz. I'll come back to this question in the next section of the of my presentation, where you can display up to a few hundred slides in the same scene. I'll come back to that. Moving on with the presentation, the ILS view, we all know how it looks like. It's a cone, you can see a top view, a lateral view, and then you have some labels like 2 minutes to touchdown, 1 minute to touchdown, and so on and so forth. You can enable and disable those labels. So that's pretty much it. That's the in-browser viz presentation. What I'd like you to remember about this one is that it's a powerful tool because it gives you access to all the recorded data and all the smoothed and computed data in the same place, while it's giving you access to a windowed visualization or simulation of the flight. As in, it doesn't give you the high definition details of a proper simulator, but it will give you an idea, a rough idea of how the surrounding was looking like and what was the scene that the event has happened. And this brings me to the Google Earth section of this presentation, and I'll come to VNode question in a few moments. Now, how do we access this module? Well, it's from the same place. Open the flight, click on the visualization ribbon, a window will pop out. You just choose Google Earth, as you can see in the left half of the window, and click download. And a file will be downloaded to your local machine. Now, this assumes that you have installed the Google Earth software. It's a free software, and you can download it, just Google it. I'm sure you know it. You can display the events and all those values that I was speaking about earlier, like key time instances and key point values, by ticking those checkboxes that I just did. Click download, and across the trajectory, you'll be able to see some pinpoints. Those pinpoints hold a lot of information about the flight, like when was the flap lever set to one, when was the flap extension, all sort of key information about it. Now, a simple thing, how you view your flight, you double click on it. In the left frame, I double clicked on the blue line, which spins the Google Earth thing to your track. Google Earth has a replay module in it. If you double click on the visualization ribbon, as I just did, you'll get a white tail, a white model that will replay your flight. And it will have a fixed angle camera, as in you're not able to move the camera around, but it's always on the same position, as you can see on my screen. And that's pretty much it. Again, it's not a high definition, but it enables you to do some things that would be very useful. I'll show you in a minute. And that's the question that we had earlier. Can we display multiple flights? Yes, we can display multiple flights, and I'll show you how. You look at your flights that you want to download or to be displayed in the Google Earth, and then you tick all the checkboxes that you want to download, as I'm doing right now. And in the window that pops out, you just choose which flight phase you want to download and other options. But the main thing, to download a few files on your local machine, and then you'll be able to load those in Google Earth, as you can see in my presentation. I hope my presentation is not too far behind my voice. Looks all right. Now, we have an option to constrain this plot, as in sometimes you might want to only send 1 mile around the touchdown area or the airport, and you don't want to send the entire flight so the recipient doesn't know where the aircraft flew and this kind of stuff. So you have this bounding box in which you're defining the coordinates for the north, south, west, and east limits, as I'm typing them right now, 54, 55.4, 55.7, and so on. And then It's the same scene that you see, that you saw previously in my previous slide. But this time, you can see the trajectories are trimmed down to exactly the area I've defined as a constraint. Now, this is a thing that I used to use quite intensively in the past. Sometimes you might want to download like multiple flights. Let's say you want to download 50 flights and you want to see if those trajectories have been spot on the design, on the assigned SID and stars. So we have two methods of doing so. The first one is called high contrast matching. And this is for the situation in which you have a chart. I usually download them from Jepsen, but some of the charts might not have an accurate enough or long enough gradation of the map. You know, on the left and on the bottom of the chart, I'll show you in a second, there are some that the GPS coordinates of the map. Sometimes those ones are not good enough or not sufficient for you to do this overlay. So in this one, you're just going to rely on the high contrast colors so that you can overlay the Google Maps, the PDF or the picture that you have with the Google Earth. In this case, I'm using the shoreline in this scene to align everything. You browse your file. That's on fast forward. After this one is done, I'll do a live demonstration so you'll see how it's being done. We have a question. Can I download the high definition picture or perhaps a GIF? You can download it, but you're not going to be able to use it. It has to be either a JPEG, either a PNG file. So back to my presentation. What happened, I've matched the blue area of the map with the sea and the white area of the map with the ground in Google Earth. And that's how we got this this scene. We have another question. If we want to simulate the air proximity collision near miss between two aircrafts, could we combine different format file, QAR, of these two aircraft to display the occurrence? Oh, yes, I see what the question is. As in, if you have two different aircrafts which record different data frames, can you load them both in the same scene? Yes, you can. It's the same thing. The only thing that I'd like you to be aware is that if you have, an aircraft with a high accuracy GPS parameters and an aircraft with low accuracy GPS parameters, then of course you'll have to treat this information with care because some of the aircrafts might have a tolerance of a few miles, like 2 miles left or 2 miles right for the GPS parameters. But generally, I used to use different aircrafts, as in on different QIR, and it was fine. Another question from Arvidas. Do you have access for the crew to check for them their flight? Yes, the crew, well, your safety officer should nominate which are the user who can access Polaris. Otherwise, still your gatekeeper, actually not your safety officer, your gatekeeper for the FDM program would be able to give guest access to specific people that are interested in a flight. And definitely I encourage everyone to, if you want to see your flight, just go and speak to your gatekeeper or FDM person and they'll be able to give you this access. Now, the second method of doing this overlay is by using a more scientific approach in which you take a map, you trim it down, and you enter the top, bottom, left and right coordinates for that map. As you can see, the same scene, I'm going to load the the PDF that I want to overlay. Sorry, I just skipped one slide without my intention. I'll go back. So again, browse to your PDF file. Come on. I'm sorry for this. I don't know why. Not yet, Heather. Thank you. Right. Again, browse your file. That's a PNG in my case. And look at the scale on the left. You can see the GPS coordinates of the map. So you just enter those ones like north, east, south, and west in there. And in this way, Google Earth will match the scaling of your chart with the scaling of Google Earth itself, and you'll have a very accurate chart. Now, what I'll do now, I'll do a live demonstration of a Google chart overlay, but I want you to decide which airport are we going to do the overlay for and which method are we going to use. Heather, please be so kind to display the questions. So I'll read the question for you. What airport would you like me to perform a map, a Google Earth overlay? So we have London Heathrow, Paris Charles de Gaulle, and New York JFK. Please vote. Well, a few more questions in the meanwhile. The chart is simply a picture. Yes, it's simply a picture. It's a JPEG picture. I see Stefan said Heathrow. Stefan, please click on the Heathrow radio button in the poll that my colleague just displayed so that we can register your vote. Yeah, that's it. And the second question will be, Heather, please, if you can display it. What? Okay, that was the, so the, sorry, Heather, the winning airport is again? It is Heathrow. Thank you for that. And now the next question is, which method would you like me to use for that? Heather, please display the second one. What overlay method would you like me to use? We have two options, high contrast matching, which is less accurate, of course, and latitude-longitude matching, which is more accurate. Now, please vote. Yes, and thank you for voting, Heather. What is the winning one? The more accurate one. Okay, I'll comply then. So I'll pause my presentation for a second now. Let me see if I can get rid of this thing. All right. And slideshow. So I'll just minimize it. So that's my Google Earth thing. Let's navigate to Heathrow. Oh, I'm already here. Somehow I assume that that's what you're going to choose. So there we are. This is Heathrow Airport. Now what I'll do, I'll load my file. I'm sorry, my voice is fading. I load my file now by clicking this button, add image overlay. You can see a new window appeared, and now it says, basically, tell me which image do you want me to overlay on this one? We have quite a few other questions. Where do flight profiles come from the map? That was from Vilius. Where do flight profiles come from the map? I'm not sure I understand this question. I'll just move on and come back to this one later. I get the picture via screenshot. Yes, you can do so. I open Jepson, I navigate to my chart, and I just save it as in entirely saving it, and then I crop it down so it only displays the useful area of the chat. You know, Jepsen has a header that, and that header has some text in it. You don't want that to be included in the chart. And the last question from Tobias, do you need the Google Earth app or can you also use the web-based version? I don't think the web-based version has this feature of image overlay. So you do need the standalone Google Earth app. Right, back to the overlay. I save my pictures in, if I just can remember, charts, and JFK is right here. I'll just preview this picture. As you can see, it's a map. It has here, not JFK, I said Heathrow. Heathrow is here, it's here. And you can see the entire map. It has a lot of information and a lot of white space. Now, a very important step is to trim down this image. And what I've did, I just trimmed down the image to these coordinates that you can see in here. On the left edge, it says here, for example, 5130, where I keep my mouse right now. And down here, it's 5030. And on the horizontal axis, you have again the coordinates. So what you do, you just trim your image to a known coordinate so that you know where you trim the image at and enter those coordinates in Google Earth. And I'll show you now how it looks like after you trimmed it down. It's called cropping. Any basic application will have this feature. So that's how it looks like when I cropped it down. I removed the white space from the image. Now I load this one in Google Earth. And there you go. The problem is right now because one mile in this image, it won't represent 1 mile in Google Earth scale. So what I like to do is click on the altitude thing and say, I don't want the image to be clamped to the ground. I want to be clamped to the seafloor. This will make it more smooth. And then on the location tab, you can see the north, east, south, and west coordinates. Now what I've did, I saved those coordinates in a text file so that I can enter them right now. I'll open that file so you can see what I'm doing. So you can see for JFK, for Heathrow, I cropped the image down to these coordinates. Now I'll just move this one like that. And I'll say the north constraint is at 51. Was 50, then the east one is at 0030, the south one is at 5030 north, and the west one is at, it's at 0230 west. This being said, we should have a fairly accurate I'll make this one smaller because otherwise you cannot see what I'm doing. So what happened in here, Google Earth just matched the top, bottom, left, and right edges of the map to the coordinates I've trimmed it up, trimmed it down. And you can test that. You can look at the shoreline. And when I decrease and increase the transparency, you can see that it overlays perfectly. Yeah, does it make sense? I hope it does. If not, please feel free to send us any questions you might have after this demo is over or whenever you feel like. Now, in my case, it saved the image in here. You can rename it as you want, and this image will be present there every time you fire up Google Earth. And you can disable or enable it by clicking this button. Switching back to my presentation. Sorry. Right. So Google Earth has some tools that you might use. You can measure distance very easily. You can put a pinpoint if you know the latitude and longitude. You can color your traces. You can measure the terrain elevation under a specific path. I just drew a line, and then on the bottom section of the screen, you can see the altitude of the terrain for that section. Now, don't forget to save your work. If you're working in Google Earth, most of the things will go in temporary places. You just right click and say save to my places. So we have a few more questions. The next one is Vilius. In the previous image you showed in your presentation, there were colorful lines that look similar to flight profiles. Where do you get that information from? Are these from airlines or simulations? Oh, sorry, now I get it. No, you download from Polaris, which is our platform. For each flight or for multiple flights, you can download those flight profiles. I don't know if you remember in a previous slide that I had multiple flights, and I ticked like 11 flights, and I clicked visualization, and then download KMZ files. So it's a KMZ file, which contains all the information for that flight profile. I hope that answers the question. If not, please feel free and ask me again, or ask me another question. You have, okay. Thank you also. yeah, Google Earth. So yeah, save your work. You have some tools that you can use. I just did a workshop, which brings us to the last section of the presentation, which is X-Plane. To summarize Google Earth in one phrase, I think Google Earth is powerful if you want to plot multiple flights. Let's say you want to plot 200 flights. That's absolutely fine. Just download them all, load them all, as I just explained after Vilius' question. Load them all in Google Earth. You just double-clicking. You double-click it and it loads in Google Earth automatically. You don't have to do anything. And then if you want to overlay a chart, fine. If you don't, you can do measurement of various distances and paths and this kind of stuff. We have one more service. Can FDS also provide this as a service? Yes, we can, definitely. All the inquiries that you have related to this type of activity, just email your point of contact, as in your analyst. And your analyst will forward you to us, or they'll do it themselves, it's depending on the situation. But yeah, just ask the question and you'll get it. You'll get the answer. Moving on, X-Plane. So the way it works, well, which versions do we support? We support 8, 9, and 10. We support version 8, 9, and 10. We'd like very much, very, very much to support version 11, but there is a bug that we cannot fix because it's not on our side. It's on the producer. It's with Laminar Research. We informed them about it, and they said they will fix it at some point, but they are not in a hurry in doing so. So in conclusion, yeah, 8, 9, and 10. How does it work? Well, it works fairly simple. The same way as Google Earth, you just download a very small file from our platform, from Polaris. It has an .fdr extension, and that file will be then loaded into X-Plane. I'm showing you right now how it's being done. Just tick X-Plane 10 or 9 or 8, whatever you want. And then just click download and the file should be with you. Open it, open X-Plane and load the file. It's nothing else than a CSV file, this FDR. It just has a header that has to have a specific format, but that's pretty much it. We have two more questions. Stefan, can a Glex be installed? I'm sorry for my lack of knowledge. I don't know what a Glex is. I think I saw the word earlier before. Can anyone?
It's a Global Express, Qatar.
Oh, yeah, that's fine. Yes, it can be installed. We support any aircraft you might have. Yes, on version 10, Stefan, and on version 9 or 8, it doesn't matter. Can we, thank you for the, it's a Bombardier Global Express BD-700. Yes, we can do it. Thank you. I'll come to this question, Stefan, in a few moments. I want to show you something. So in this screen, I've loaded all the parameters in X-Plane, and you see one column is one parameter. It's with a simple, with a frequency of 1 second, as in one time per second. Now I just want to show you briefly, I won't spend too much time on it, how the FDR file is being structured. So it's the data, the many and small numbers that you can see on the screen, those are the parameters that have been recorded. And then the header contains some information like the model to be loaded and time of the flight. What I want you to remember is the fact that for the model, you can load anything you like, a fridge or a whatever, and it will fly the same way as your aircraft because it doesn't use the physics engine. And time of the flight, if your flight was at night, it was pitch dark, you can modify that variable to make it day. So it's a, also, you can see the events in this section. I'll just scroll quick through those things because it doesn't really matter. There are things that we export in this FDR file, and then when you load the file into X-Plane, they will be displayed, as you can see on the top bar. You have some labels. Those are the events that have been triggered in this flight. And then you have a hash along the trajectory that you can see right now. That's an event that has occurred during that flight. And also the event is being spoken as a text. Now we do design our own aircraft, that comes to Stefan's question. As you can see, we either start from scratch or use existing models, or either way we'll provide you with a customized aircraft with your painting scheme and your model. Matt is asking, are there any plans to extend this to Microsoft Flight Simulator? Are there any plans to extend this to Microsoft Flight Simulator? Yes, we're looking into it. I looked a few times into this option and we're considering giving it a go. I don't have a yes or no answer for you. It's just that we're analyzing other options also. Ardana is asking, we experience problems with spurious data sometimes occur during validation. Could you share any requirements of or best practice about number of it which be tolerated? I'm not sure that I understand the context. As in, are you speaking about events that have been triggered and they weren't accurate enough, or if you can just expand a little bit on this question, Ardana. I'll move on because time-wise, I still have 8 minutes left. One thing to consider is, does your aircraft record enough parameters to get a good simulation? We are able to import 118 parameters. But as you can see in the left screen, in the left half of the screen, you can see a Hercules, which records about 10 parameters. And in the right half of the screen, you can see an Airbus, which records about 600, 700 parameters. So the outcome for those aircrafts will be very different. And yeah, that's a thing that you want to consider for your fleet. If an airport is missing, we're going to design it for you, or just send it to you, or guide you through the process. It's up to you. If you want us to do it, we'll do it. There are no costs involved. Because customize the weather, yeah, you can put CAVOC or CAT1, CAT2, and CAT3 as options. So Ardana came with a further explanation on the question. When we read out the data, it displays strangely and could not be interpreted. Is that okay? So probably that's because of so which parameters are we speaking about? Do we speak about latitude and longitude, or we're speaking about other parameters that just don't make sense for you. We have another question from M. Boardman. Can you display just the track for multiple tracks in a 2D view or a SID or start plate? Yeah, no vertical profile. You're speaking about a 2D view. Yes, you have some sort of tool for doing so, but I would recommend if you want to see a 2D view for a SID or a star, I would recommend go and try Google Earth with the method that I just described. You download the star from Jepsen, you do the overlay, download multiple flights or one flight, and that's a very useful thing to have because you can measure everything you want in there. Oh, Ardana came with a further explanation. Usually data about the activation of GPWS warnings or speed break. That's not exactly the topic of this webinar, but this one can be handled very easily. If you can just send us an email with an example, like a flight that has been triggered incorrectly, we'll take care of it. Because, well, we can double check the parameter to see if everything is good. But if the parameter is broken, perhaps it's better to have it disabled rather than triggering false positives. We'll come back to this one just a bit later. Just email me the flight, Ardana, and we'll speak after this webinar. I'll just move on with the presentation and then come back to questions. We have 7 case studies to see how some of our customers have used X-Plane in the past. And here we have an aircraft trying to land. I'll just play the flight and wait a bit because you might experience some delays. So in this case, the pilot was aiming for the middle runway, but in the last moment, he noticed that the runway is shut, as in out of service, and he decided to land on the other runway. Just that in the process of doing so, he stalled the aircraft at about 30 feet off the ground. I'm sorry that you cannot hear the stall warning. And then he hit with the left wing tip one of the runway lights. So this simulation has been done in version 11. I know that I said it doesn't work. It works for just small sections, short flights. Yeah, that was an example. I'll just move on. We had some more questions, but they have been cleared. Any questions that I haven't answered, please feel free to email me. My colleague Heather will give you my email address. The case study number 2, we have an aircraft flying at cruise and suddenly, it stalled, basically. I'll let you watch the evolution of the aircraft. As you can see, we have some instruments in the right half of the screen. I just turned off my video because I think it's using quite a lot of bandwidth. And you can see the aircraft stalled and then recovered and continued its flight without any further incidents. Now, 2 weeks later, another customer flying the same type of aircraft comes with the same kind of request. This time is the same aircraft, the same type of aircraft, but in a different area of the world. You can see the instruments are on the left side. I've blanked some of the information. As you can see, a label on the throttle quadrant saying not recorded. This is because the parameter wasn't recorded and we just removed those parameters entirely. Or we just hide those if the information is not relevant. Number 4, it's a runway excursion. It happened a while ago, but there were no injuries. What I wanted to notice is the fact that the rudder surface is moving in accordance with the position of the recorded parameters as the spoilers have just been deployed. Number 5, sorry for going so fast right now, but I think I'm about to exceed my allocated time. This is an uncommanded pitch up due to a technical malfunction. the aircraft climbed, it stalled at the top of it, and then it recovered and went for another try, and the second attempt was fine. When it reached the hangar, it was proven that in fact it was a technical malfunction. And this one is an aircraft trying to land in Alaska. What's interesting about this is the fact that this aircraft didn't record it lat and long, as in latitude and longitude. So we did compute this track by using ground speed and heading and position on the ground. And that's what we got. You can see here a bit of a forced turn. This is because we try to align in this case, because it didn't record any lat and long, try to align the trajectory with the landing position, or with the landing runway. So that's how we ended up with this one. Thank you very, very much for your patience. I hope you enjoyed my presentation. And any questions you might have, please don't hesitate to get in touch with us, get in touch with the panelists of these presentations, and they will forward you to me or any of my colleagues who will be very happy to help you. Thank you very, very much again. Thank you, Stefan. And I'm looking to see you again soon, perhaps like in person, not via webinar. Thank you also, Javier. Thank you, Stefan. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.